The learning objectives of this section are to make shipboard operational personnel familiar with the external forces experienced on a ship hull in still water due to cargo loading. The external forces experienced on a ship hull due to sea forces from wave actions. A ship's structure may be considered as the material that provides the strength and stiffness to withstand all of the forces that the ship may reasonably be expected to experience. The hull girder comprising fore and aft ship and cargo areas must have the strength to withstand the full range of internal forces from sources as light ship weight, fuel, cargo, and ballast. The hull girder must also withstand forces occurring during launching and dry docking, and as a result from sea forces like slamming, racking, and thermal effects, as well as sloshing in partly filled tanks. Static forces are set up by general cargo, dry bulk cargo, liquids in tanks, the sea. Static forces from general cargo are transferred to the adjacent structure only in the vertical direction, while liquids in a tank set up static forces like pressure differences, which act in all directions. The effect of static forces from dry bulk cargo will be in between forces from general cargoes and liquids. Grain, for instance, will affect both horizontally inclined and vertical surfaces. The static sea pressure acting on the submerged hull will balance the static weights of the ship and cargo. Since the forces are not evenly distributed along the hull, forces have to be transferred and bending of the hull girder will take place. When the hold is unloaded, the surplus of buoyancy will put the double bottom in a hogged mode. With a partly loaded hold, the double bottom may be straight. When the hold is completely filled, the double bottom is sagged because the cargo weight is greater than the seawater pressure. The side shell will also deform because of the increasing seawater pressure on the side shell, and the hopper acting like the so-called fixed point. Dynamic forces will primarily act in the same plane as the static forces. If they work in the same direction, the dynamic forces will be added to the static forces. The dynamic forces are set up by the water particles surrounding the ship. The hull girder, as well as the local elements, is affected. The largest dynamic forces are experienced in the bow area. Dimensions of the structure based on worst case considerations. For the hull girder, worst case with regard to the effect of forces and moments due to regular waves is when a wavelength between the crests is approximately equal to the length of the ship. The dimensioning of the hull girder longitudinal strength is based on the maximum design loading condition and wave conditions, causing highest stresses in deck and bottom. The worst case considerations are when the wave crests are fore and aft, the ship will be in sagged condition. If the wave crest is amidships, the ship will be in extreme hogged condition. A Additional stresses originate from pounding and panting conditions. Bearing the brunt of the wave encounters and having the largest combinations of pitching and setting movements, the foreship is naturally exposed to dynamic forces. Three types of dynamic forces are considered: slamming, in way of flat bottom forward at light draft; impact pressure forces, in way of abrupt or flared bow; pressure forces caused by green water on deck, particularly on the forecastle deck. The results may be indent of bottom plating, indent in plating on forecastle deck and main deck, in way of pillars inside forecastle. Ships with a relative large depth may be subjected to significant transverse forces. These forces are rolling and pitching forces, acting in transverse direction and causing significant stresses in the transverse bulkheads. Where one hold is empty and the other is full, opposing forces are acting at each side of the transverse bulkhead, causing shear stresses in the ship's side. This is particularly relevant for the open hatch type of bulk carriers and the car carriers. Another type of a dynamic force is sloshing in tanks that are partly filled. Significant additional forces may be set up in the tanks filled with liquid cargo or ballast. This phenomenon takes place when the natural frequency of the liquid coincides with the pitching or rolling mode of the vessel, and no means of hampering the movement of the liquid are introduced, like swash bulkheads in oil tankers. To prevent harmful forces, there may be restrictions on the filling height of tanks. For instance, filling between 20 to 90% of the tank volume may be prohibited. Guidance on how to avoid excessive liquid pressure will usually be issued to the ship as a part of the loading manual. Dynamic forces are very much influenced by the skill and with the care a ship is operated. Good seamanship and competent handling in bad weather are very important factors of reducing the damages on the ship.